get back, and now I want to shift gears and be more focused on what I would want you to all think about as you think about your careers, and then how you prepare for your careers, and whether Holt might be a good place to do that, okay? So before I became an engineer, I almost became a history major. I love history, and I very much thought I wanted to be a professor of history. And then one of my history professors took me aside one day and said, it's a tough way to make a living. There may be another approach, right? He coached me out of it. But I continue to love and read about history. And one of the great historians, a British historian by the name of Paul Kennedy, wrote this book called The Rise and Fall of the Great Powers. Now, he was talking about empires. He was talking about nations. He was talking about Greece and Rome and China, okay? And maybe with Trump, America soon, okay? Maybe that's the next domino that's going to go down, God help us all, okay? But what I want to talk about is the rise and fall of the great corporate powers, the great brands, like Blockbuster, like Gillette. A very, very smart Austrian economist by the name of Joseph Schumpeter said, economic progress in a capitalist society means turmoil. When someone makes money, more often than not, someone gets hurt. It's just the law of business, okay? What is a remarkable thing to understand is since the year 2000, over half of the Fortune 500 vaporized, not because a magician showed up and made them disappear, because they were not prepared for the disruption that was coming at them. They didn't keep up with the technology, they didn't keep up with business models, and as a result of that, many, many people have been laid off, have seen their career stall, have made decisions that did not lead to a satisfying professional life for them, okay? What's also remarkable is that in the era when my dad was about halfway through his career, hello, Cassie, the average age of a company, the average lifespan of a company was almost 70 years. Today, it's 15 years and falling like a brick, right? Why do you think that is? Why is the lifespan of a company one-fourth, one-fifth, one-sixth of what it used to be? What's happening? What's going on? What's that?
Globalization.
Globalization is a part, but globalization has been around for a while, right? It's also, well, so new business models, asset-light business models, obviously technology, right? Ever since 2007, when the iPhone and Twitter and all of these massive social platforms were created, just because you work for all doesn't mean you can, okay? A lot of things are changing. That's what we're going to talk about, right? So, a long time ago, right, if you go to business school, one of the things you learn is frameworks, lots and lots of frameworks, okay? We can go on and on. But this was the framework of the day. This was called the Growth Share Matrix from the Boston Consulting Group. And in the lower left-hand corner, right, in the Boston Consulting Group, like McKinsey or like Bain, this is a very prestigious strategy consulting firm. They work with the CEOs and chairman of the board of the biggest companies in the world. Maybe here you would call the managing directors, right? Very expensive, very prestigious, very elite. And this is how they would guide CEOs and managing directors to run their businesses. If you want to leverage your business, if you have what they call a cash cow, it's almost like having an internal bank. You can continue to fund the rest of the business forever, and you can kind of just let that business run at steady state. There's no need to worry about it. It's arrived, it's generating a lot of cash, okay? But it turns out that assumption became wrong very quickly. And so the operative phrase is, we are living in very tumultuous times, okay? Whether you want to talk about geographical or geopolitical or weather or climate, but certainly technological, very, very, very challenging times. And when the winds of change blow, you have a choice. You can hunker down, you can take refuge behind a wall, you can go into the basement or the cellar, or you can say, you know what, this is an extraordinary time to harness change, to use change as a way of creating a new business model, creating an advantage that others don't quite see yet. Okay? And that's the world that I like to live in. I don't like to live out of fear. I want to have a different experience. I want to be have the courage of my convictions and make bets on what I think the future is going to hold. Okay? Jack Welch, one of the great CEOs in history, the CEO of General Electric, one of the best managed companies ever in terms of the amount of wealth that was created by GE over many years. I've had the privilege to spend some time with him. He is the most inspirational, professional, corporate guy I've ever met. Okay? A remarkably inspirational guy. Change before you have to. How easy is it for people to do that? Is that human nature? Do most people change before they have to? Do people like change? Most people do not like change. Most people run away from change. If you're a leader in a corporation today, if that's who you are, let someone else take the steering wheel, okay? Because you're going to go off the road and into a ditch, okay? We have lived through numerous industrial revolutions. The first industrial revolution started in the late 1700s. It was driven, starting in London, England. There was an industrial revolution based on both mechanical power and steam power, okay? And then, around the time of some great people like Tesla, right? Nikola Tesla and Marconi and Thomas Edison, the second industrial revolution began in the late 1800s, and that was when the electrical grid was created, and we no longer lived in darkness. And companies that failed to go from mechanical and steam to electrical got decimated. They got taken out at the knees. And then the third revolution is really the information revolution, the computer, the PC, okay? A lot of the digital things that we understand today. We are now on the precipice of the fourth industrial revolution. When Amazon, or now Mercedes-Benz and DHL and others, deliver stuff via a drone, that's an example of the fourth industrial revolution. When people are using artificial intelligence the way that Alexa, the Amazon Echo speaker that has taken over so quickly, is being adopted by even grandmothers, that's an example of the industrial revolution, okay? The fourth industrial revolution. When you see driverless cars on the road in pilot cities like Pittsburgh and Boston and San Francisco, autonomous vehicles is a part of the fourth industrial revolution. It is the first time that you bring together digital technology with physical stuff, okay? Robotics on the factory floor. And so what's happening now, so disruption is not new. Disruption has been happening for hundreds and hundreds of years. Okay? Every time new innovations, new inventions get introduced to the market, there are people that are paralyzed by fear, and they just say, everything's going to be fine, just the way that Blockbuster said, everything's going to be fine. Okay? So we've gone through many, many, many different periods over the last several hundred years, from the textile industry, to the railroad industry, to auto, to computer, to distributed intelligence, where companies that were leaders in one era completely vaporized because they didn't have the vision to move ahead. Now, if you know this guy on the right, his name is Thomas Alva Edison. Thomas Alva Edison has over 1,000 patents to his name. He created the first innovation factory in Menlo Park, New Jersey. And I will tell you that he was 100 years ahead of his time. He was not an educated man, but he was a genius in every scientific and mechanical discipline, chemical discipline you can imagine. And there was no limit to the kind of inventions that he came up with. He almost single-handedly drove the adoption, right? Many people knew how to create electrical current. What he did is he made it real. He created the electrical grid so that when you walked up to a light switch, you actually had light, okay? You needed to create power plants and electrical distribution lines, okay? What he did was truly remarkable. And with that invention, everything changed. Everyone before that, right? In the years from 1901 to the Great Depression of 1928, 1929, it was very clear that electrical energy was a vastly superior for everything changed.
Running a factory that
everyone before that, right? In the years from 1901 to the Great Depression of 1928, 1929, it was very clear that electrical energy was a vastly superior form of running a factory than coal or steam. And yet, right, 60% less cost than running coal. And yet many people resisted. They were complacent, like who's the end? Human nature, I just don't like change. It cost a lot to switch. Well, of course it does, okay? They didn't have the specialized knowledge. As a result of that, 40% of the companies in the world at the time went away, they failed. Another 10% basically became zombie companies. They didn't have any, they had no future, they just went all. So of the 42 most dominant firms of the time, think of them as the Fortune 42, okay? Most of them saw at least a third decline in market cap or revenue. So this is not new. We've seen this movie before, okay? And this is what Detroit looks like today. If you saw the movie 8 Mile with Eminem, right? This is Detroit. Detroit was the ostrich. They had their head in the sand. There were all of these new cars being created in Japan and Europe. And Detroit just wanted to pretend everything was just fine. And this is what it looks like today. It's a third world country in the middle of America, okay? Because of terrible management crap.